Good morning and welcome to outdoor worship service at Little Chapel on the Boardwalk on this first Sunday of the Advent season. We are glad that you're here. We especially want to welcome you if you are a first-time visitor. And to those who will be watching this online a little later on this afternoon, a special welcome. And to those who are listening on our radio station, if you would like now to come and stay in your vehicle, if you turn on to 105.9 FM, you can listen to Little Chapel's worship service on your FM radio dial. So all of you who are here, a welcome. Now this is the final Sunday that the mission committee is going to be over here for the alternative Christmas market. So if you have not yet placed your order, please do so today. The table will be up in the narthex all this week for those who want to place an order, but this is the last time they'll be here at the table this morning. Also, we still have over here for Salvation Army Christmas stockings. If you'd like to help do that, you're encouraged to do so. And we also continue to collect shoe boxes, which will be used for our Meals on Wheels on Christmas Day. And because we begin the season of Advent this morning, we do have some Advent devotional booklets that are over here, compliments of your worship committee. We do ask, though, you just take one booklet per family. The Boy Scouts are down at the end of the parking lot by the Matthew House. If you ordered a Christmas wreath, you can pick your wreath up today from the Boy Scouts following our service this morning. Also, as we begin the season of Advent, this is the time we have one of our four Presbyterian Church USA major offerings, and this is the Joy Offering. And the Joy Offering helps current church leaders and retired church leaders and their families during times of need. So if you would like to participate with a Joy Offering, if you will simply memo your check, Joy Offering, and put it in the offering bucket when it comes around a little bit later. But we will be receiving that special offering over the next three Sundays. Also, if you haven't yet had an opportunity to turn in your pledge card, you can put it in the bucket this morning. There are some extra pledge cards over here. You can, if you want to mail it into the church office, that is fine. And on this first Sunday of Advent, a special thanks to Janice Allen. Janice helped us get our communion table set up with the nativity scene and our Advent wreath, so we can at least pull a couple of the traditions that we are used to inside to bring them outside. And again, a thanks to Gary Kahunsky for doing our videotaping, for David Heinzman for providing us with the inspirational music, for Lori Holcomb for being our song leader, and for Barbara Tindall for taking care of getting everything set up for us. And now a special thing that really is happening tomorrow. But Patty Sider turns 91 tomorrow. Patty is sitting right over here. I think we need to sing happy birthday to Patty. And now, wherever you are worshiping from this morning, let us prepare our hearts and minds as we worship together the risen Christ. Thank you. The words to our call to worship are printed in your bulletin. Let us join responsibly to stand watch over a sick child or a rising loaf, at the gate of a factory, upon the ramparts of a walled city, or on the craggy top of a mountain, calls for alert senses and sensitivities.
Standing watch demands an awareness of surroundings, for even when it seems as though there is nothing out there to watch for, we must be ready for anything.
Standing watch builds anticipation.
In this season, we seek to watch with eagerness for the promised but always surprising arrival of Christ. God comes to be with us, ready or not. May our worship this morning and in the days ahead be times of looking forward with perspective and receptive watchfulness.
Our hymn of praise this morning is Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
And this is symbolized not only by the four-week period of preparation, but also by lighting of an Advent candle on each Sunday of the season. The four candles provide us with a visual way to count off four Sundays of this season. The flame of each new candle reminds us, the worshipers, that something is happening and something more is still to come. The tradition of the Advent wreath is tracked back to an old Scandinavian custom that celebrated the coming of light after a dark season of darkness. In that day, candles were placed on the edge of a horizontal wheel, and as the wheel was slowly spun around, the lit candles would blend into a continuous circle of light. Today, the candles are arranged in a circle to remind us of the continuous power of God, which knows neither beginning nor ending. There is also symbolism in the color of the candles. The three blue candles symbolize the coming of Christ from the royal line of David. He is coming as the King of Kings as well as the Prince of Peace. The pink candle will be lit the fourth Sunday of the Advent season, as this candle represents joy. The large white candle in the center is known as the Christ candle and points to Jesus as the Christ, the light of the world. We are lighting the first candle to represent hope. Long ago, people had hoped in their hearts as many waited for a Savior, someone who had come to set people free. We hope, too, for the Savior's love to be shared with our friends to cover the world.
I practiced all week long, and it came on every time I did it. We are symbolically lighting the Advent candle this morning. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness." Let us pray. Lord God, you have filled our past, you are filling our present moment, and you will fill our future together with hope, peace, joy, and love. Thank you for the crying baby long ago that brought hope to our own future, joy to our spirits, peace to our minds, and love to our relationships. Thank you, O Lord, for the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, into our lives. Amen. We'll sing this morning the first verse of our responsive hymn.
To confession. As a new church year begins, we seek to leave behind our past unfaithfulness. We remember our doubts and neglect, the empty times when prayer is forgotten and our focus is narrowed to petty concerns.
God is waiting to hear from us. Let us pray.
Let us join now together in unison in our prayer of confession. Awesome God, we confess the sin of our separation from you. We have blamed you for hiding from us, rather than admitting we have failed to see you in the thousands of ways you are revealing yourself every day. We have not called on you, and we have not listened for your call to us. Without you, we have become tiny islands of self-concern. Our links with the rest of your children are stretched and broken. Oh God, we long for that loving community in which your reign is acknowledged and your purposes are served. Move us to that place, we pray. Amen. Hear now these words of assurance of pardon and respond. God's grace has come to us in Jesus Christ. God restores us to a right relationship with the eternal, that we might rightfully value ourselves and all persons. Spiritual gifts are ours to claim. God is faithful and will strengthen us to face all circumstances. Praise God, the source of all things. Let us pray. God, our helper, by your Holy Spirit, open our minds that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, We may be led into your truth and taught your will. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Old Testament lesson this morning is Isaiah 64, the first 9 verses. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you. As when fire set twigs ablaze and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the mountains to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God beside you who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continue to sin against them, you were angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the winds of our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have given us over to our sins. Yet, Lord, our Father, we are the clay, you are the potter. We are the works of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, Lord. Do not remember our sin forever. Oh, look on us, we pray, for we are all your people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of Mark, the 13th chapter, beginning with the 24th verse. Hear God's word for us today. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branches become tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. For truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware. Keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our hymn of preparation this morning is printed in your bulletin. Christians are gathering in churches and in parking lots like we are to celebrate the first Sunday of the new church year, the first Sunday of Advent. Our text for the day announces one of the major themes of the season of Advent, and that is the expectation of the coming of Christ in all of his glory at the end time. This first Sunday of Advent is about the future coming of the crucified and risen Christ. The crucified and risen Christ who will come to judge the principalities and powers of evil. This season begins today with Mark making a rather bold proclamation here in the 13th chapter. And that is, Christ will ultimately prevail over the brokenness of this world. And Mark tells us here in the 13th chapter some rather scary things about the end of the world. The eclipses of the sun and moon, meteors and shooting stars, all these provide Mark with metaphors that help to announce the appearance of the heavenly Redeemer and Judge. But what matters most here is not so much what Mark says is going to happen or the details about how things are going to come to an end, but the fact that when things do end, it will all be on God's terms and in God's time. And so according to Mark, we better watch. We better be ready. The keynote of this first Sunday of the season of Advent is about waiting and watching. Waiting and watching for signs of Christ's return, just as those first followers of Christ had been watching and waiting for a king to be born, someone who would come to them and free them from Roman oppression. They were looking for a king who would lead them. And so today, we wait. We wait for the king's return. That's the message of Advent, and no matter what we do, we can't end the waiting game. We can't do anything about it. The end, the judgment, the kingdom of God will come when God is ready, not when we are. Until then, we must live by faith. We must live not knowing about the future, but having a faith and trust in God that whatever the future will bring, it is God's will for us. You see, what's really important here in this text from the Gospel of Mark is not about the grim projections. It's not even about what John tells us the end is going to be like in his book of Revelation. But the call is for us to keep our eyes wide open as we wait and anticipate Christ's return. And as we wait, as we watch, as we anticipate, we live in hope. The coming of the Son of Humanity carries with it a timely message of hope. And that's another important part of this Advent season. Hope. It's not about living in fear, but getting in touch with our hopes. I know that it's true that fear can spur us on. It can get our attention. It can wake us up. But fear can also paralyze us. It can make us want to run and hide. It can paralyze us to a point of non-productivity. My dad was a person who believed that if you did something wrong as a child, then you should be punished for it. Now, many years ago, there was no such thing as time out. I would have considered it a reward to be sent to my room when I did something wrong. When I was growing up, though, when my brother or I misbehaved, we got a spanking. Now, that fear of getting a spanking probably kept me out of a lot of trouble. There were things I didn't try because I didn't want to be caught by my father, and normally we were always caught, and I didn't want to get that spanking. So in a way, fear paralyzed me from doing things that were not considered right to do. But we today, as a society, we have to move away from allowing fears to stop us from doing what we should do. We have to get in touch with our hopes. And we start by asking, what is it that I'm hoping for? What is it that drives us to get out of bed every morning? This is not a season where we have to watch and wait fearfully, but watch and wait with anticipation and with hope. But how does the hope of Christ reveal itself in today's complex, anxiety-ridden, fear-filled world? With racial unrest, political battles, economic downturns, natural disasters, and yes, COVID-19, where is the hope? If we were to look at the bigger picture of all this and what's happening around the world at this time, we might think to ourselves, we are in the midst of the end times right now. For the world is changing. The old ways and even the old way of doing church are beginning to die off, and we can feel it. We are caught at times between loyalty to the old and fear of the new. So where is the hope? What is hope? One definition is that hope is believing in the possibility of a favorable future. It is the opposite of weary, fear, and despair. It could be said then that hopeful people live positive and fruitful lives, or at least they attempt to do so. Hope implies a certain discontent with the way that things are and propels people to work for a more desirable, God-pleasing future. Hope has to do with expectations more than desires. For us to hope is to wait with open arms for a future that we count on being worth living. And so we go and meet that future with eagerness and with anticipation. Hope does not expect that the future is going to be what we want it to be, but it's about our attitude as we move out to meet the future. A future the contents of which we cannot know in advance. Hope then is a way for God to bring balance and stability to our lives. But if God provides us with hope, then in God's own gracious way, why does it seem that so many of us are so anxious? Why is it so difficult for hope to be found, especially in this supposedly most hopeful time of the year? Maybe it's because we have either failed to look for it or we're looking for hope in all the wrong places. Well, Advent is the answer for us. It is answer for us in that this is a season of hope. Something is dawning on the horizon of our lives if we only open our eyes to see it. The very meaning of this time of year is about someone or something coming. The word Advent is derived from the Latin word Adventus, which literally means coming. Each year during Advent, we are called as a community of faith to prepare for the visit of God's salvation. Our work is to anticipate that which God will do to bring fulfillment to all people. We are preparing for the event in the stables at Bethlehem that brings us together. The hopes and fears of all the years, as Phyllis Brooks wrote in his O Little Town of Bethlehem. Advent is when the church proclaims the approaching righteousness of God. It is a crucial proclamation because it is a real source of hope for each and every one of us. The world, our lives, our days cannot be without hope. And as we anticipate eagerly what God is going to do, we can be energized as the faithful followers. But hope isn't cheap. It never has been. Hope demands energy and faith. And this is true because we need hope when we face desperate circumstances. And the church itself must draw its energy of faith as it offers the world a vision of the newness that God brings forth in His Son, Jesus Christ. The proclamation must be so bold that our anticipation can be without hesitation. People of faith do not put their trust either in themselves or in other people. People of faith do not put their trust in their own strength, intelligence, or their ability to cope with life. People of faith put their trust in God, for God is our only hope. Eugene Peterson, who was the author of The Message, wrote a devotional entitled Hope on the Line. I want to share with you a few of the excerpts from that devotion. Every day, Peterson writes, I put hope on the line. I don't know what the next hour will hold, There may be sickness, personal or world catastrophes, but before this day is over, I may have to deal with death, pain, loss, rejection. I don't know what the future holds for me, for those who I love, for my nation, for this world. Still, despite my ignorance and surrounded by optimists and pessimists, I say that God will accomplish His will, and I will cheerfully persist in living in the hope that nothing will separate me from Christ's love. And as we begin this season of Advent, that is our prayer. Our prayer and our realization that as we move through this season together, that nothing will separate us from God's love. As we go to God in prayer this morning, I know there are many needs and many wants, but I simply want to lift up this morning Peggy Gentry. Peggy fell this past week and broke her arm, and she's going to be having a pin put in her arm on Tuesday. So I want to remember Peggy and her family and all the other needs that are part of our church family and our extended family. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, you whose promises are sure and secure, we enter into this season of disciplined anticipation with a disadvantage, O God, of the knowledge of knowing the outcome. We know how this familiar story of Advent will turn out. So, Lord, we confess that mysteries of things of the past seem to no longer strike us or amuse us or even have a way of making us feel excited. With no mysteries even under the tree, O Lord, everything seems to have lost the mystery of anticipation. Well, Lord, in our hurried lives, we need the gift of anticipation today. We need it because we have lost the ability to wait. We have lost the ability to cherish the moment, to embrace uncertainty. We've lost the ability, O God, to live by faith. We crave certitude, especially in these uncertain times, O Lord. With threats to body and spirit, we want answers and solutions. But instead, O God, you continue to give us mysteries, visitations by angels, and you ask us to wait for that day. And so this morning, O Lord, we ask for the gift of anticipation, that we may believe and live in the humble spirit of a young girl who was given a gift, who whispered a mystery, and who was told to wait for God to act in that day. Lord, in this Advent season, give us the gift of anticipation, that we too may see your mysteries unfold in our lives and in the lives of our families and friends. We pray this morning, O Lord, in the name of the Christ child, who grew up and became our Savior and who taught his own followers to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates. Let us stand as we sing. And as we sing, we'll receive our morning tithes and offerings. Following our closing chime, those who would like, if we could have some help in moving everything inside, it would be greatly appreciated. And now may the God of love, peace, joy, and mercy go with you this day and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.